the dua. And the essence of the dua is what? Is admitting your need and your weakness to the one who is self-sufficient, subhanahu wa ta'ala, al-ghani, Allah azza wa jal. You're the poor, you're the needy, he's a self-sufficient, subhanahu wa ta'ala, al-ghani. That's the essence of making that dua. And the best dua that you make, if it has jawami' al-kalim, which means collective meanings that put in few words. And that was the style of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And yesterday we learned the dua that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to repeat most frequently. And if you guys remember that, it was also a very short dua, but it's very common, probably we don't pay attention, but it was the one that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to repeat the most because its meaning is really profound. What is that dua? Do you remember the dua, Jama'ah? Allahumma atina fid dunya hasana wa fil akhirati hasana wa qina adhab an-nar. Ya Allah, give us that which is good in this dunya, that which is good in the hereafter, wa qina adhab an-nar, and save us from the fire of hell. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from the fire of hell, rabbil alameen. Say ameen, jama'ah. Today we have another dua from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is jawami' al-kalim. Same thing, which is collective, few words, but have profound meanings. Let's repeat this dua. Let's first learn this dua, inshallah ta'ala, first. The dua is, an ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa arda, actually was reported to be Abu Mas'ud al-Badri radiallahu anhu, anna nabiyya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam kana yaqul, he used to say, Allahumma inni as'aluka al-huda wat-tuqa wal-afafa wal-ghina. Just four words. Out of all the things in this world, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to ask Allah azza wa jal four things. What are these four things? Allahumma inni as'aluka al-huda. Ya Allah, I ask you. Which means, I beseech you for guide, I beseech you for this. What is that? Number one, huda. What does the meaning of huda, jama'ah? Do you guys know? Guidance. That's what we know of it, right? Wat-tuqa. And what is tuqa? Piety and righteousness, taqwa, right? Wal-afaf. What does afaf mean? Now it's getting a little bit difficult, right? Chastity. It means chastity. Wal-ghina. What does ghina mean? To be rich, self-sufficient. So let's talk about these, inshallah ta'ala, and let's see what the correlation, why these words are together, and why would the Prophet ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for these things. So, number one, he says, Allahumma inni as'aluka. As-su'al, in the Arabic language, of course, when you ask, request. But here it comes in the form of begging. That's what it means. Like, oh Allah, I beg you for. That's what it means. Is it okay to beg Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, jama'ah? Is it okay to beg people? Why not? Because begging people is showing your weakness to them. But begging Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is admitting His greatness to Him. And to yourself as well too. So it's okay to beg Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for your things. What are these four things? As'aluka al-huda. Al-huda, we translate that into the word guidance, we said, right? But ulama of the hadith, they say actually it's more than guidance. It's much more than that. So if they say, could be more comprehensive, more specific, when you say guidance, more specific, what is it exactly that you're looking for? What do you guys think? Knowledge. Al-ilm. Guidance, what does it mean exactly? To know what to do, what not to do. To see the path and walk through or stay away from it. That's the meaning of the essence of guidance, right? That you have the proper knowledge by which you can do the right thing and stay from the wrong thing. And that's why there's another dua that we say, Allahumma, arina al-haqqa haqqan, warzuqna attiba'a, wa arina al-batila batila, warzuqna ijtinaba. Ya Allah, show us that which is right, and for us to recognize it to be right and follow it, and that which is wrong, and to recognize that it's wrong and stay away from it. Now that's based on what? Knowledge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran says, also, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِن تَتَّقُوا اللَّهَ جَعَلْ لَكُمْ فُرْقَانًا. You, oh, you who believe, if you truly have taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He'll provide you with furqan. What's furqan over here? Furqan means criteria by which you could see that which is right and wrong. Now that is provide knowledge, jama'ah. وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَيُعَلِّمُكُمُ اللَّهِ. You have taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will give you that knowledge. What that knowledge we're talking about over here? That guidance that we're looking for. So that's the first thing. Ilm, you ask Allah, Allahumma as'aluka al-huda. I ask you for guidance, which means for ilm, knowledge that by which I can see where to go. I can go through it easily. But when it comes to specifically, guidance also has another meaning, which means tawfiq. At-tawfiq is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides your heart, you know, naturally to do the right thing. So that in itself is a blessing, is a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah gift us the tawfiq and guide us, ya Rabbil Alameen. Not everybody, ya jama'a, gets that. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّكَ لَا تَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتِ. You don't give guidance to whomever you love. وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. It is He who guides whom He wills, subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah make us among those who are well guided, ya Rabbil Alameen. And guidance, according to Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, is three categories. So when you ask for guidance, keep that in your mind. He said, هِدَايَةٌ إِلَى الصِّرَاطِ وَهِدَايَةٌ عَلَى الصِّرَاطِ وَهِدَايَةٌ فِي الصِّرَاطِ. What does that mean? You need guidance to the straight path. Because you're out of the path, you need to be in the path. So you're asking Allah to guide you to the right path so you can go walk through it. Then guidance to stay on the path. هِدَايَةٌ عَلَى الصِّرَاطِ. Because not everybody who goes on the right, on the straight path stays there, ya jama'ah. Some people drop out. Allahumma musta'an. May Allah protect us from this. So you ask Allah for guidance to stay on the sirat. وَهِدَايَةٌ فِي الصِّرَاطِ. Also guidance through the path. Why so? Because there are a lot of levels, a lot of categories. I don't want to be behind. I want to be always forward. I want to keep going forward and advance in my life, in my path of guidance. Al-Islam, Al-Iman, Al-Ihsan, as we know. You grow until you reach that level of Ihsan, excellence. So this is what it means actually, that we need to look for guidance and ask Allah for guidance. That's the first thing. The second thing, wat-tuqa. What is tuqa? Obviously now, guidance provides you with what? When you have that guidance, what does it provide you? That consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the heart and the mind. And that's the essence of taqwa. You build a shield between you and what Allah made haram. I'm not going to approach that. But how can you build that shield if you don't have the knowledge for it? And if you don't even know what you're shielding yourself from and how you can acquire that shield itself. So that's why we say, wat-tuqa. Ya Allah, give me guidance by which I can build that shield that will protect you from falling into the haram and the wrong thing. And taqwa obviously here is subhanAllah, is the essence of everything. As Allah says, وَالْعَاقِبَةُ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. The best result on the day of judgment and in the dunya are for those who are most righteous. May Allah make us from the muttaqeen, ya Rabbil Alameen. So he says, أَسْأَلُكَ الْهُدَى وَالتُّقَى. We talked about taqwa so many times, but at least we understand it's having that full consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the form of piety and righteousness. Number three, wal-afaf. Now, al-afaf could be two things. One of them is chastity, al-iffa, which means chastity over here, which is part of taqwa, right? But it was singled out because it is one of the most important thing that most people unfortunately fall into the sin because of shahawat, their desires. So that's why chastity becomes important. And the chastity means is what? Not to commit the haram, specifically al-fahisha or zina. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us and our loved ones from this, ya Rabbil Alameen. So you ask Allah for guidance and help people that shield to protect that guidance and specifically stay away from the fahisha. You need to be shielded from that fahisha over here. That's one translation for the meaning of afaf. There's another meaning for it. It comes from the iffa, which is ta'affuf. And that means to not to ask people, which means to be above the needs the need for other people. So that is the iffa. Even though you might be in need, but you're not going to go and ask people, as Allah Subhanahu wa Taala describes in the Quran, al-masakin, the needy people. What do you say? يَحْسَبُهُمُ الْجَاهِلُ أَغْنِيَاءَ مِنَ التَّعَفُّفِ. That the one who is not aware of them probably perceive them as agniya, they're good, they're well off. But they're not. But they appear to be so because they're muta'affifin, they have the afaf or iffa, which is basically not asking people for anything. And then the last one comes after this, wal-ghina. Ya Allah, I ask wal-ghina. Al-ghina also one of two things. Whether ghina means wealth, because I'm in need of your blessing, ya Rabbil Alameen. So that ghina is the wealth that Allah could bless me with, the blessing that comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the essence of that is what, ya jama'ah? The essence of that is that I would need absolutely nobody else. In the hadith we mentioned one time in the khutab, is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's mentioning things important to us. He says, wastaghni an nas. If you don't ask people, you will be elevated to the highest level. And that is the meaning of staying away, don't need the people as much as you can. Try to do your things on your own. Whether it's a question that you need looking for answer for, or money or a physical request and so on, as much as you can. If you can stay self-sufficient, that's good. However, still, we are in need of each other as human beings. There's nothing wrong with that. But the less you depend on people, the more you depend on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the more you become ghani and self-sufficient, and the more you get from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that protection. The other meaning of here, al-ghina, also to be ghani from falling into the haram. So alhamdulillah, yastaghni an, so you're not gonna need that haram because Allah protected you. You have chastity. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. So these are four important topics that the Prophet has asked you to ask Allah Azza wa Jal for in this dunya. And if you look at the majama'a, this is basically a sign of dependence completely on Allah Azza wa Jal. Well, it goes back again to the essence of what? Of ibadah and dua. So there are four items. Number one, al-huda, guidance. Number two, at-tuqa, which means conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, righteousness. Number three, al-afaf, chastity. And number four, al-ghina, to be alhamdulillah sufficient in a way that you don't need the people, but you need Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, only Allah azza wa jal. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us al-huda, والتقى والعفاف والغنى يا رب العالمين. So let's repeat this dua three times إن شاء الله تعالى. اللهم إني أسألك الهدى والتقى والعفاف والغنى. اللهم إني أسألك الهدى والتقى والعفاف والغنى. اللهم إني أسألك الهدى والتقى والعفاف والغنى. اللهم آمين. Any question يا جماعة؟ ما شاء الله. We're gonna start taking questions inshallah in the next sessions بإذن الله عز وجل. So if you have any question on the subject, please do so. And for those also watching us online, you feel free to ask your question in the comment section. We will get you your answer inshallah تعالى بإذن الله عز وجل. Yes.
I do have a question.
Go ahead.
I heard a hadith where the Prophet said, you know, there was a sahabi used to make a lot of dua, and he said, some said that if you say,
salawat ala nabi, yeah.
You know, the more you do that, your dua will be accepted too.
So he said that someone was making dua and he thinks dua was not accepted, so the Prophet ﷺ guided him to say the durood, which is Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Durood, you say, you know, yes. from one third to one half, you know, he used to make a lot of dua, so if you do durood.
I'm not sure about the technicality of the story you're reporting right now, but definitely salawat ala Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is highly recommended within your dua, whether at the beginning or at the end, because it's probably more likely to be accepted if it includes salawat upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. Jazakumullah khair. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.